Welcome to lecture number 2 on spur gears. In the previous lecture, we had discussed about the various power transmission mechanisms and we discussed about the definition of gears and the different classification of gears. So today we will discuss about the gear terminologies associated with the spur gears. Right. So here we will be exploring about the theory of the gear tooth action and the kinematic design of the gear drives which we see in our everyday life. There will be a specific shape of the teeth that you are going to look into while analyzing the gear terminology, but we will explore the geometry of that in detail at a later stage. The complete design of a gear involves material selection as well as the complicated stress analysis. But here in this chapter, we will not be dealing with the stress analysis part or the material selection with respect to the gears. Our discussion will be limited only to the kinematic design or the gear tooth theory behind the design of spur gears. Right. So the fundamental requirement in most applications of the gears or any other power transmission mechanism is to make sure that the velocity ratio or the gear ratio remains constant. It only indicates that velocity ratio remains constant, indicates that there is no power loss. When the power gets transmitted from the driver to the driven, there is no loss in the power. Right? So that is the meaning of the velocity ratio. This requirement imposes a restriction on suitable geometry for the gear teeth, and in this case we have chosen the involute profile. On a later note, we will be comparing the various types of profiles for the gear tooth geometry. Right? So in order to achieve the exact velocity ratio to prevent slip and the power loss, right? So a number of projections are provided. So let me consider this as wheel 1 and wheel 2. So this is the profile that I have on wheel tooth, right? So this gap between the two teeth is going to be called as the recess. So teeth from one of the gear will mesh into the recess of the another gear. So when the gear 2 or the gear 1 begins to run in the clockwise direction, correspondingly the gear 2 begins to rotate in the anti-clockwise direction. So most of the time we use the gears to transmit power from two very small distances, because compared to any other drive such as belt drive, chain drive or rope drive, so the input and the output will be at longer distances and they will not be in contact. The driver pulley and the driven pulley will not be in direct contact with each other. But in case of a gear drive, the driver pulley and the driven pulley will be in physical contact with each other, making them effective only for transmitting power over very short distances. Right? So we will explore a geometry like this. We will be considering few teeths on a spur gear, and with respect to that, let us try to explore the various terminologies that are associated with the gears. To begin with, we will start with something called as a pitch circle. A pitch circle is an imaginary circle that is found at the point where the two gears are going to mesh. So let me assume that this is the point where the two gears are going to mesh with each other. So let me say this is where, when they come, they will be in contact with each other. Now, to draw the pitch circle, it is very easy. But we have to remember that it is only imaginary in nature. So this will be the center. Let me call this as the driver gear or the driven. Let me call the bigger one as the driven and the smaller one as the driver gear. So this will be the center of rotation of the driver gear, and this will be the center of rotation of the driven gear. With respect to this as the center and the point where the two gears will be in contact with each other. So this will be the place where the two gears will be in contact with each other. With this as the center and this as the radius, I am going to draw a circle. That gives me the pitch circle of the driven gear. Similarly, with respect to this as the center and the point where the two gears are in physical contact with each other, that this distance as the radius, I am going to draw a circle. So that gives me the pitch circle for the driver gear. So this is how we can establish or we can draw the pitch circle for both the gears which are in mesh with each other, driver as well as the driven. But we have to remember that pitch circle will act as a reference to define all other terminologies, and it will be only imaginary in nature. right? And the procedure to construct or to procedure to identify the pitch circle has been outlined. The next terminology will be the pitch circle diameter. The diameter of the pitch circle will be simply be called as the pitch circle diameter. Most of the time it will be also called as PCD. And the next terminology is the pitch point. There are two alternative definitions to the pitch point. The first definition will be that wherever the two pitch circles are going to meet, the two pitch circles of the driver gear and the driven gear, the point of contact of two pitch circles, that we are going to call it as the pitch point. Both the pitch circle of the driver and the driven, they will be meeting only at one point, and always that point remains stationary. So pitch point is a stationary point. It is not going to move. Though the two pitch circles are in rotation, they will be making contact only at one point, and the point of contact of two pitch circles, we are going to call it as the pitch point. The alternative definition is, suppose I don't know the pitch circles, how to identify the pitch point? So for that, we should know the point of contact of two gears, right? So tangential to that, I am going to draw a line. So this will be called as a tangent line, and this will be tangent to the point of contact of two gears. So perpendicular to that, if I draw a line, that will be called as a normal line, and I can simply call it as common normal to the point of contact. And this will be the point of contact. Now, to identify the pitch point lies on the intersection of common normal to the point of contact, which is nothing but this line, to the line joining the center of rotation. So this will be the line that joins the center of rotation of the driver and the driven gear. Right. So at the intersection of that, we will have the pitch point. This is another alternative way to identify the pitch point when we cannot recognize, or we do not know how the pitch circles, or we do not know how to identify the pitch circle. So pitch point lies on the intersection of common normal to the point of contact with the line joining the two centers of rotation of gears, that is driver as well as the driven. Right. And the next definition is the addendum, the radial distance of tooth from the pitch circle to top of the teeth. So this will be your pitch circle, and this will be your top of the teeth. The radial distance from the pitch circle to the top of the teeth, we are going to call it as the addendum. Addendum circle is nothing but the circle drawn, or that circle that passes through top of the teeth and which is concentric to pitch circle. So this is the circle which passes through top of the teeth and it is concentric to the pitch circle. We call that circle as the addendum circle. So addendum is nothing but the radial distance of the tooth from the pitch circle to the top of the teeth, and addendum circle is circle that passes through top of the teeth and it is concentric to the pitch circle. Similarly, didendum is nothing but radial distance of the tooth from the pitch circle, this is the pitch circle, to the complete bottom of the teeth. So the radial distance, this radial distance, we are going to call it as the didendum, and the circle that is drawn or passes through bottom of the circle, the complete bottom of the circle, we are going to call it as the didendum circle. And most of the time, the didendum circle is also called as the root circle. Right? And the next definition is the clearance or the base circle. This is the most important definition because we have to identify the difference between didendum circle, root circle, or the base circle. The base circle is also called as the clearance circle. It is nothing but the circle from which the involute portion of the tooth profile is generated. So this is the point. Right? This is the point, or this is the circle which I am going to call the base circle. So below the base circle, whatever the profile or the geometry that we have will not be the involute profile. Only if the two involute portion of the gears mesh with each other, velocity ratio will be constant and the sliding will be very minimal. Right? So now below the base circle, we will not be having the involute portion. The actual involute portion will begin only after or above the base circle. All the portion that we have shown now above the base circle will have the involute profile, and below the base circle we will not be having the involute profile. So the distance between the root circle, the didendum circle, and the base circle, we are going to call it as the clearance, and the clearance portion will not be having the involute profile. So for all our future references, we will be considering only the base circle and not the dedendum circle. Right? And the next definition is the clearance. So now from this definition, we know that the depth of the dedendum or the height, radial height of the dedendum will be more compared to the addendum, because the dedendum comprises both the clearance circle as well as the dedendum circle. The radial height difference between addendum dedendum, we are going to call it as the clearance. So this difference between the base circle or the clearance circle and the dedendum circle, we are going to call it as the clearance. And one more way is, so if I consider this as the driven gear, if the driver gear comes, so its top portion will come only up to the clearance circle. It will not go below that, because below the clearance circle, it will not be having the involute profile and they may get damaged if they go below the clearance circle. So this is what you see here. So this will be your base circle. This will be your dedendum circle, and above the base circle, this will all be the involute portion. So the gear that comes to mesh in the recess will only come up to the clearance circle or only the base circle. It will not go below the base circle, as below the base circle, there will be no involute portion. So coming to the next definition, that is face of the tooth, the surface of the gear tooth above the pitch surface. So this will be the pitch surface. The surface above the pitch surface, we are going to call it as the face, and below the pitch surface, we are going to call it as the flank of the teeth. And coming to the next definition, that is the face width, length of the teeth in the axial direction. So along the this, we are going to call it as the radial direction along the diameter. So perpendicular to that, we will be having the axial direction. So length of the teeth in the axial direction, we are going to call it as the face width. And the next definition is the tooth thickness, distance from a point on one side of the gear to a corresponding point on opposite side of the same tooth. So I am going to consider a point on one side of the gear, right? So corresponding opposite point on the other side of the same gear, right, or on the same teeth, the distance measured along the pitch circle, we are going to call it as the tooth thickness. So this will be the point on one side of the gear, the corresponding point on the opposite side of the same gear will be this, and the distance measured from one point to the another point along the pitch circle, we are going to call it as the tooth thickness. As simple as that. So coming to the next definition, that is the circular pitch, the distance measured. So this will be quite similar to the tooth thickness. The distance measured on the circumference of the pitch circle from point on one tooth to corresponding point on the next tooth. So let me call this as teeth number one and teeth number two. Right side end of tooth number one, that is where the profile is going to begin. So right side end of the tooth number two, that is where it is supposed to end. So distance from one point, the distance from a point on one tooth to a corresponding point on the next tooth, right? And the distance measured along the pitch circle, we are going to call it as the circular pitch. Mathematically, we can call it as pi into d by t, where capital D stands for diameter of the pitch circle, or simply the pitch circle diameter, and capital T stands for number of teeth on the wheel. For the two gears to come in mesh with each other, driver and the driven, both should have the same circular pitch. Only then they can transmit power from driver to driven. If a driver has a circular pitch of 2 and driven has a circular pitch of 3, then they cannot mesh with each other. That is how we can understand the significance of the circular pitch. It is also represented by P subscript C. This is how we represent circular pitch. Mathematically, pi into D, which is nothing but the circumference of the pitch circle diameter divided by number of teeth. So that is how we can define circular pitch. So the next terminology is the module. It is a terminology which indicates how big or small your gear tooth is, individual gear tooth is. Now we can observe how the gear tooth size varies from a module of 0.5 to 6. For a module of 0.6, we observe that the individual gear tooth size is very, very small. So when the module becomes a 6, right, on this, now we observe that the gear tooth size is much bigger. Mathematically, we can define the module as D by T, where D stands for the pitch circle diameter divided by the number of teeth. So if the module is 1 or 1.5, the gear tooth size will be very smaller compared to that of a module with a size of 6. So that is what we are going to see here. So it is nothing but on the numerator you are going to have the pitch circle diameter, on the denominator you are going to have the number of teeth. So this is how we can identify or you can visualize how the module, the increase in module increases the gear tooth size. For a module 1 we have comparatively less gear tooth size, module 2 and module 3 the gear tooth size begins to become bigger. The another terminology is the diametrical pitch, which is exactly the inverse or opposite to that of the module. Module we defined it as ratio of pitch circle diameter to that of the number of teeth. So here it will be ratio of number of teeth to that of the diameter of the pitch circle. It indicates number of teeth of the gear per inch of its diameter, right? So for example, if I have 32 teeth and the diameter is 8 inches, right? Then the diametrical pitch is 4 teeth per inch. So per inch, I will be having 4 teeth. That is what I am going to identify. So whenever I am going to indicate the diameter should be indicated only in inches, not in millimeter or meter. That is how we are going to identify the diametrical pitch. That the denominator, that is the pitch circle diameter, should be indicated only in inches. So per inch of the diameter, how many teeth I am going to have. So we can, through this figure, we can identify how the tooth size is going to vary as the diametrical pitch is going to vary. For a diametrical pitch of 4, it indicates that per inch of the diameter, I am going to have 4 teeth. 1, 2, 3, 4. That is the meaning of diametrical pitch of 4. So similarly, I can have a diametrical pitch of 64, right? That indicates that per inch of the diameter, I am going to have 64 teeth. That indicates that for a diametrical pitch of 64, gear tooth sizes will be very, very small compared to that of a diametrical pitch with 4. For a diametrical pitch with value as 4, the gear tooth sizes will be much bigger when compared to a diametrical pitch of 64. So that is what we can visualize through this diagram. The next definition is the center distance. It is nothing but the distance between center of the driver shaft to that of the driven shaft. So this will be the center of a driver shaft. This will be the center of the driven shaft. The distance between them, we are going to call it as the center distance. And the next terminology is the pinion. So whenever two gears are in mesh with each other, as we see, usually one will be a bigger gear and one will be a smaller gear. Usually, most of the time, majority of the times, the smallest gear is called as the pinion, and pinion most of the time will be the driving gear, because most of the time, not all the time, 100% of the time, majority of the time, our objective will be to decrease the speed and increase the torque. So with respect to that, pinion will be usually the smallest gear out of the two available gears which are in mesh with each other. The smallest gear, right, and the driving gear will be called as the pinion. So here we see that. So this will be smaller when compared to the bigger internal gear. So that will be called as the pinion, and most of the time, not all the time, pinion will be the driving gears. So similarly, correspondingly, we have gear, wheel or cog. So I said that when two gears are meshed with each other, one will be smaller and one will be bigger. The smaller will be usually the driver, called as the pinion, and the bigger will be called as gear, wheel or a cog. Now if you see this animation here, so the smaller one will be connected to a motor which will be rotating at a very high speed. My objective is to reduce the speed and increase the torque, right? So this gear, which is going to turn very slowly when compared to the pinion, is can be called with three names, that is gear, wheel or a cog. And usually gear, wheel or a cog, or the bigger wheel, will be a driven gear. That is what we can appreciate. And coming to the next terminology, we have something called as the gear ratio, right? So it is nothing but ratio of number of teeth on the wheel or gear. So wheel or gear are nothing but the driven, and the driven will be indicated by a subscript of 2, and it will be indicated by capital T, right? So it is the ratio of number of teeth on the driven. So I can simply call wheel or gear as driven, and pinion, right, will be called as the driver. So number of teeth on the driven to the number of teeth on the driver. So it will be indicated by capital T, this will be indicated by small t, or this can be indicated by T2 and this will be indicated by T1, right? If I use the numbers or capital small letter or numbers T1 and T2. So gear ratio indicated by capital G will be nothing but the ratio of number of teeth on the driven gear to that of the driver gear. So driven gear will come on the numerator, driver gear will come on the denominator. What exactly is the significance of gear ratio? We will appreciate it in the next slide. So similar to gear ratio, we have another terminology called as the velocity ratio. So gear ratio is very specific only to gear drives which have teeth on their periphery, but velocity ratio can be applied to any power transmission mechanism such as belt drive, chain drive or rope drive. So velocity ratio will be defined with respect to angular velocity, whereas the gear ratio was defined with respect to number of teeth. So velocity ratio is nothing but angular velocity of the follower or the driven to that of angular velocity of the driving gear. So coming over here, the ratio of angular velocity of the driven, which is indicated by 2, so omega 2 by omega 1. So on the numerator we have omega 2, which is angular velocity of the follower or the driven, divided by omega 1, which is angular velocity of the driver. Now we can relate omega 2 by omega 1 with respect to three terminologies: one with respect to speed, another with respect to diameter, and another with respect to number of teeth. To relate omega to angular velocity to speed in RPM, we will make use of relation number 1. We know that omega will be equal to 2 pi n by 60. Omega is angular velocity, n is speed in RPM. So both are related by 2 pi n, omega equal to 2 pi n by 60. So omega 2 will be 2 pi n 2 by 60 and omega 1 will be equal to 2 pi n 1 by 60. So 2 pi by 60, 2 pi by 60 cancels with each other, and relationship between angular velocity in radian per second and speed in RPM will be omega 2 by omega n will be equal to n 2 by n 1. That is possible. And the next relation should be with respect to the diameter. For that, we will use the velocity on the periphery of the wheels. So that will be represented as pi d n. We know that velocity can be represented as pi d n. So pi d1 n1 will be equal to pi d2 n2. So for both driver gear as well as the driven gear, velocity on the periphery should be equal to each other. Pi d1 n1 equal to pi d2 n2. So pi pi cancels with each other. So d1 n1 will be equal to d2 n2. So that is a relationship I am going to get. Now the ratio n2 by n1. So n2 by n1. So if I want to have n2 by n1, so then d1, so I should be able, so n2 by n1, so that is what I want. So if I bring, if I bring n1, so n1, n2 by n1 here, so then we are going to get d1 by d2. So this d2 comes to the denominator here. So n2 by n1 will be equal to d1 by d2. Now we see that n2 by n1 will be inversely proportional to the diameter, the velocity ratio. That is n2 by n1, both omega 2 by omega n and n2 by n1 will be velocity ratio. They will be inversely proportional to the diameters. N2 by n1 will be equal to d1 by d2. So similarly, to have the relationship with respect to number of teeth, right, I can make use of the definition of circular pitch, that is pi d by t. So for the driver gear, it will be pi d1 by t1. For the driven gear, it will be pi d2 by t2. Right. So now d1 by d2. So if I take here, pi and pi will get cancelled out with each other. So if I bring this d2 to the denominator, t1 will go to the numerator. So d1 by d2 will be equal to t1 by t2. So this is how we can have the velocity ratio, right? Omega 2 by omega 1 or n2 by n1 equal to d1 by d2 or t1 by t2. So what is the difference between velocity ratio and gear ratio? Now if you observe here, the velocity ratio with respect to number of teeth, it will be T1 by T2. Number of teeth on the driver divided by number of teeth on the driven. But if you go to gear ratio, it is the reverse, T2 by T1. Gear ratio is T2 by T1, velocity ratio is T1 by T2. So therefore, if you want me to differentiate between gear ratio and velocity ratio is the inverse of the gear ratio. Then where do we make use of the gear ratio and velocity ratio? Velocity ratio is used in common for all the kinds of power transmission mechanisms, such as belt drive, rope drive, chain drive, gear drive, anything, right? So whereas gear drives are specific only to gear drives which have teeth on their periphery. If I do not have the teeth on their periphery, so for velocity ratios, D1 by D2, diameter of the driven, diameter of the driver is more than sufficient. Diameter of the driver pulley, diameter of the driven pulley, more than sufficient. But to define the gear ratio, I should have number of teeth on the driven divided by number of teeth on the driver. So that is how velocity ratio is different when compared to the gear ratio. Gear ratio is very specific to gear drives, whereas velocity ratio will be very specific, is common to all power transmission mechanism. So what exactly is the meaning of gear ratio? So gear ratio indicates we are in case of the gear ratio, we are going to give more importance to torque rather than speed. So here you can consider the example of the gear ratios in an automobile gearbox. So the first, so if I have 2.97:1, so that is what I have here. So the first term represents the driver and the second term on the right side represents the driven, right? So if you want me to simplify this, so instead of 2.97, I'm going to call it as 3:1 or 3:1. So it indicates that, so 3 will be the driver, which is usually smaller, and 1 will be the driven, which is usually the bigger. So this will be bigger, this will be smaller. So in the first gear, my objective is to have more torque, right, and less speed. That will be my object in the first gear, because I want to make the vehicle move. For that, I need more rotational power. I get more rotational power only when speed is less and torque is more. So now this indicates that the ratio 3:1, it indicates that when the driver gear rotates by 3 times, driven is going to rotate only once, right? So if the driver gear completes 3 complete revolutions, only then the driven gear will complete 1 revolution. That means the speed is going to drastically reduce and correspondingly the torque is going to increase. On the contrary, if I come to the 6th gear, that is the highest gear, you observe that when the, I can summarize this as 0.5:1. This indicates that this is usually smaller and this is usually, so when it comes over here, we see that when the driver gear completes 0.56 rotations, only it has not completed 1 revolution, only when it completes 0.56 rotation, driven gear would have already rotated by once. So when it completes 1 complete revolution, it would rotate by 2 times. That means that the speed is given more importance in the highest gear and the torque will be very less when compared to the first gear, because the vehicle is already in the move. My objective is to increase the speed. I will be giving less preference to the torque at the highest gear. So that is how we can understand the gear ratio 3:1, 0.5:1. So when I say 3:1, I am giving more importance to torque. When I say 0.5:1, I am giving more importance to speed. Coming to the reverse gear, right? Coming to the reverse gear here, they have -3.38:1. That means that when the driver gear rotate 3.38 times, driven gear is going to rotate only by once. Because for the reverse, we need the highest torque when compared to all the gears that are, all the arrangements that are available. So that is how we can understand the importance of gear ratio in the gears. Because in the gear ratio, we can easily address whether a torque is important to me or speed is important to me. So with respect to an automobile gearbox, in the first gear, torque is important. At the highest gear, speed is important. So that is how we can appreciate the gear ratio. Gear ratio is nothing but ratio of number of teeth on the driven gear to that of the number of teeth on the driver gear, to give something like this with respect to a gearbox. Right. To summarize, these are the gear terminologies that we have discussed so far. In the next lecture, we will be discussing about the pressure angle, which is a very important aspect with respect to gears. Right. So this ends lecture number 2 on spur gears. Thank you.